Sometimes you want to truly scare your players with a deep, brooding fear. And other times, you just want to throw out a basic jump scare to annoy hardcore horror fans. I don't particularly care about horror, so let's make a jump scare. Now, last year I did a tongue-in-cheek version, but for this year, I want to show you how to make a jump scare that is view independent. So, no matter where you look, it will hit you in the face. So, here's how you go about doing so. Okay, so to achieve this effect, we're going to use a camera that overlays the player's view. First, let's make a new camera. To do so, we want to come over to the hierarchy, right-click, and select camera. Now, whenever you create a new camera, it will have an audio listener component on it. Make sure to delete it, otherwise Unity will complain that you have two in your scene. With that out of the way, let's explain a bit about cameras. Now, I'm just going to drag and drop our game tab to be next to our project window so we can see what the player sees. Now, whenever you have two cameras in your scene, and you haven't given a camera a target texture, it will render alongside the main camera, and they will compete for what the player sees. Now, if your camera depth value is more than -2, then this camera view will be rendered on top of the player's view. We can see that our new camera, with a default depth of 0, is completely overriding everything we normally see from our main camera. If we were to bring our camera outside of the building, we can see both the world and the Unity default skybox. However, if we click on our camera's clear flags, we can see a couple more settings. First, we have a solid color, which doesn't really help us, but the other ones, depth and no clear, are the ones we're more interested in. Selecting either of these will make our camera render only the parts that it sees, and the rest just shows what the main camera sees. This is what we'll use for our jump scare. Now, there is a distinction between the two, and that is that depth setting will always render on top of the other camera, while no clear will allow it to clip through objects to make it look like there's actually an object in front of the player. In more basic terms, use no clear if you want the players to be able to hide behind their hands and objects, and use depth if you don't. I'll be using depth in this tutorial, as I want the camera's jump to be visible even through the wall. Cool, so now that we have our camera, I'm going to move it up so it can't see the map, and then I'm just going to put a spider model in front of it. With that, we can now playtest. And now we just need to turn on our camera, and we can see a lovely spider hanging on our player's face. Awesome! However, VRChat's a VR game. Things are never that easy. You see, while the spider may look good on a 2D screen, in VR you see in 3D, so the size of the spider matters. Because of this, you need to make sure your spider is the right size, which mine is because I tested this earlier. However, even if they're right, we now have the camera to worry about. You see, when you have a camera in VRChat, if you're playing in desktop mode, the camera doesn't move around when you walk and turn around. This is the same for VR, but only for the controller inputs. If the player looks around IRL, the second camera also rotates. The same happens for any play space movement they have. However, while there's a bit of a pain, it isn't too hard to fix. Back in Unity, you can fix the position problem by making our spider a child of the new camera. That way, no matter how much the player moves, it will stay looking at the player. Lastly, I'm just going to make this camera way higher, so no matter what way you are looking, it can't see the main world. By the way, if someone knows how to create a shader that forces transparency so you can hide sections of the world, I would love to know about it. So now, with that out of the way, there is something that is super important! Whenever you have a second camera in the scene, always make sure that you only render the bare minimum layers. To do this, come over to the culling mask and select none. Then, select only the layers that you want the camera to see. Honestly, it's best if there's only one. This will save a ton of performance and is massively reduces the amount of draw calls coming from the new camera. If you don't do this, you are going to tank people's frames whenever you just want to give them a simple jump scare. For me, my spider's on the default layer, so I'm going to select default, and that will mean that the camera is only looking at the default layer and not any other layers. Okay, so now if we were to playtest this, if we turn on a camera, we can see the spider. If we were to move, rotate, or scale our camera, the spider moves with it and there is no problems. And if we look straight down, we can't see anything else either. Awesome! Now, you've probably noticed that we have to keep turning on our camera component, but why is that? Well, this seems to be a safety measure done by VRChat to catch anyone who forgot a camera that they left on. To fix this via code, we just need to re-turn on our camera when we go to use it. So, I reckon it's time we write a script. On the camera, just come down to Add Component, and we want to add an Udon Behavior component. I'm going to come over to the project window and I'm just going to right click create VRChat Udon Udon Graph Program Asset, and I'm going to call this jump scare object because I can't think of a better name. Then I just want to come over to my camera and drag and drop it into the Udon behavior component that we just created, and I'm going to open up the Udon graph. Now that we're in the graph, this code is actually really simple. Basically, whenever this object is turned on, we want to enable the camera. So we just want to use an event on enable node. If you don't know about events, feel free to check out my tutorial all about events and how we use them to learn more. And then we just want to use an event set enable node on our camera. For its value, we want to turn this camera on, so I'm just going to checkmark that. However, we need to tell it what camera to turn on, so I'm just going to come into my variables tab and hit this plus button, and I'm going to create a camera variable. I'm going to call it this camera. I'm then going to hit this drop down and make it public so I'll be able to select it inside the inspector. And then I'm going to drag and drop it into the instance slot. So if I hit compile and come back into our scene, we need to tell it our camera. So I'm just going to drag and drop our camera into our Udon behavior component, and then we can hit play. And now that we're in the world, we can see that the camera turned on when the game began. Now if we're to stop playing, turn off this camera, and then playtest it again, we can see that we don't have the spider in front of our face. But as soon as we turn on our camera game object, we can now see the spider. Awesome! Okay, but a jump scare that sticks around for too long isn't a very good jump scare. So how can we make it disappear? Well, if I was to stop playtesting, what we need to do is add a little bit more to our code so that, say, after 2 seconds, the camera game object turns itself off. For this, we'll need to use a custom event. So in our code, I'm just going to create an event custom node. I'm going to call the event disable object, and I'm going to get this event to play a game object set active node. And just for readability, I'm going to use a this node. And now we have an event that whenever it is played, it will tell our object to turn off. So we should tell it when we want this event to play. That would be 2 seconds after our event on enable has been called. So we just want to use an Udon behavior send custom event delayed seconds node, give it the event name, and then for the delay, we're going to give it a value of 2 to delay it by 2 seconds. So now in summary, whenever the object is turned on, it will play the event on enable. The camera will then turn itself on so we can actually see the spider. Then it will play this node, which will tell the custom event to play after 2 seconds. Then, 2 seconds later, this custom event will play and the object will turn itself off. Awesome! So hit compile, come back into our scene view, and hit play. Now if we just turn on our camera, we can see the spider, and then after 2 seconds, it disappears again. And if we do that again, we can see that it works the same the second time. Cool, so now we have a reliable way of making this jump scare automatically reset itself. However, a jump scare that doesn't have any sound is a bit boring and doesn't really sell the surprise. So how about we add some sound to this jump scare? To do so, I'm going to go to our camera, hit add component, and I'm going to add a VRC spatial audio source. I'm then going to scroll all the way down. I'm going to open up its advanced options and turn off spatialization. This will make it sound like it's playing in our ears instead of coming from a location in the world. Then, as the camera is far away, I'm just going to make the far distance value stupidly large so it reaches the player. Okay, and now, last but not least, I just want to point out, because people keep missing this in my tutorials, but on the audio source, we have this checkmark for play on awake. This is true by default. This will mean that whenever this object is enabled, turned on, the game object begins, it will start playing the sound. Make sure this is ticked, otherwise when you turn on the object, it won't start playing the sound. Okay, but now we just need to say what sound we want it to play. So I got the spider jump scare sound that I found online, and I'm just going to put that into the audio clip source. So now when we playtest, we can see that whenever we activate our game object, it plays the sound with the jump scare before disappearing after 2 seconds. Awesome! Okay, so now we've got it all working when we turn on this object, we just need a way of turning on the object, say whenever we walk into a trigger. So let's make a trigger. I'm going to come over to the hierarchy and I'm just going to right click and create a cube. I'm then going to adjust it to be roughly how I want. Then on the box collider component, I'm going to set isTrigger to be true. This will mean that we can actually walk inside the object instead of just walking on top of it, which wouldn't really work. Now, we can also make this cube invisible by disabling its mesh renderer, but I would refrain from doing that until you know everything is working. Having it been visible seriously helps with bug fixing. Okay, so now we want this cube to trigger our jump scare, so for this, we need an Udon script. We just want to come down to add component and create another Udon behavior component. Now we need a new script to go inside this Udon behavior component. So I'm just going to come over to the project window. I'm going to right click and create Udon graph program asset. And I'm going to call this jump scare trigger. Then I want to click on my cube and I want to give it the new Udon behavior and then open up the Udon graph. Now that we're in the graph, this second script is also really simple. For this script, we just want to make it so that whenever the player walks the trigger, it toggles on our camera game object, which will then make the jump scare play. So the event we want to use is event on player trigger enter, and this gets called whenever the player walks into the trigger. Now if we were to use this event as it is, it will play the jump scare for all players. But I find most jump scares best when it only plays for the person who touched the trigger. So I'm going to check if it's the local player that entered the trigger, and not just a random player. To do this, I'm going to use a player API is local node, and then plug it into a branch node. And so now with this, the true arrow will only play when the local player has walked into the trigger. And then I just want to plug the true arrow into a game object set active node, which will allow us to turn on the camera. We will, however, need to say what object we want to turn on. So I'm going to come up to the variables tab and hit this plus button and create a game object variable. I'm going to call this target object, and then I'm going to hit the drop down and make it public so we're able to see it inside the inspector. And then I'm going to drag and drop it into my graph and plug it into the game object set active node. Then for the node's value, we just want to make this true so the object will turn on. So now we're all good. Now come up here and hit compile, and do make sure you actually hit compile because the last change wouldn't have caused Udon to auto-compile. I probably should have done it the other order so I don't confuse people. Anyways, come back into our scene. With our trigger cube selected, we just want to drag and drop our jump scare camera object into our target object variable slot. Now when we go to playtest this, we can see that whenever we walk into the trigger, it plays a jump scare. Okay, well, so that's the basics. However, I really want to give some movement to the spider because currently it just kind of stands there. However, that would require animating all the legs, so for this tutorial, let's do a simpler animation. I'm going to use one of the joke spiders from last year's jump scare tutorial as an example, and this will allow me to show you how to create a brand new jump scare. Now, the more jump scares you add, the more your hierarchy will get messy. So I'm actually going to create an empty game object and then make all my parts of my current jump scare a child of it. Then we can just duplicate this new empty game object and it'll copy everything as well as the trigger reference to the new camera. So now I just want to slide this empty so the triggers are not overlapping. Now coming over to our new camera, instead of using the spider, I want to use a different object. To do so, I can simply drag and drop our new object as a child of the camera and delete the old spider. Then we can just adjust its position, and now if we were to playtest this, when we enter the new trigger, we see the joke spider instead of the normal spider. However, I really want this to slide in front of the player. So in order to do that, we need to create an animation. I'm going to go to the animation tab, and if you don't already have it, you can come up to window animation animation. I then want to select our object, and then in the animation tab, click create. I'm going to call this animation jump scare 1, because why not? That's actually a pretty bad name, but this is just a tutorial, and I normally label it something a bit more appropriate for the scene. Anyways, now that we have an animation, I'm going to click the record button on the animation tab. I'm then going to give our object a little wiggle to record its basic rotation, and then rotate it to the new position. Then I'm going to select both ends and go linear so the animation doesn't speed up and slow down. If all goes well, you can hit the play button and we'll see the object quickly jump into view, which hopefully will be scary, at least in a funny way. I'm also going to tweak the speed here just to make it play a little faster. Awesome! Now, animations loop by default, but we don't really want that for this type of animation. To stop it from looping, we just need to pop into the project tab, find where the animation is, and untick loop time. And now when the animation finishes, it will stay on the final frame. In fact, that's about it. Now we can see that if we hit play, we can see that whenever we walk into the trigger, it enables the object, then it slides into place, halts, and then disappears. We can also change the sound to be the old one from the other video by swapping out the new camera's audio sources clip and giving it a new sound. And now it plays our new animation with the old sound. We can now also walk into both of them and see a kind of atrocity between the two. Okay, so now that I've shown you how to do animations with this, we can do way more with the jump scares. For example, here I have it where the spider moves in front of the player. This is far better than the static spider, and while it may have a bit more animation bits to it, it was made the exact same way as the basic one that I showed you. And then we can also expand upon it again and use a second animation that makes the spider jump at the player. For this, there were two animations, with one being the spider wriggling and the other being the spider jumping at the player. This gives a really good effect, and I think this one is finally one that I can actually think is kinda good. Now, if you're unsure as to how I set the animator to play two animations, or you're just confused with my brief explanation of how to make them, I recommend looking at more general Unity tutorials. In fact, if someone knows a really good solid one, please comment it down below. I'd love to know a good one to send people to. So, anyways, hope you found this helpful. Feel free to leave a like on the video if you liked it, leave a comment down below if you have any questions. I now have links to my Discord and Patreon down below, and feel free to check out some of my other tutorials that I have on the channel. But until next time, bye!